far as the scientists who doubt evolution not having scientific degrees, well, that's a really a strange claim to make. Certainly the British Museum of Natural History is a place where the scientists have degrees. And in 1998, in 1981, excuse me, in their centennial, they had some displays where they actually said, and this caused a great furor because the evolutionists didn't like them saying this, but they said the idea of evolution by natural selection is a matter of logic, not science. And it follows that the concept of evolution by natural selection is not, strictly speaking, scientific. They said, we can't prove that the idea is true, only that it has not yet been proved false. It may one day be replaced by a better theory, but until then, et cetera, et cetera. This is what the scientists at the British Natural Museum said. If you want to question their credentials, you may do so, but I'm afraid you're not very well read if you think that all the people who question evolution are pseudoscientists. There's many mainstream scientists who've written books about this, and many philosophers of science, like Thomas Nagel, the atheist, who wrote just this year, Mind and Cosmos. The subtitle is Why the Materialist Neo-Darwinian Conception of Nature is Almost Certainly False. He's a philosopher of science. There's many philosophers of science and many scientists who say the same thing. So, Truman, I think you're being a little, you're just not skeptical enough. I'm a considerably more skeptical person than you are.
15
you
seconds.
You seem to just want to believe what people tell you rather than look into it and check it out.
Okay, when I get my stopwatch lined up here, sometimes it's stubborn, it's resetting. Oh, it didn't reset. Try again. But anyway, now we're going to go into a series of 1 minute back and forth. So this is where you can feel what the other person says, and I would recommend if you are inclined to pose a question to your opponent. So anyway, Truman, you get to go first. You've got 1 minute.
Okay, Steve, I would say, you know, 1981 display in the museum, are you serious? That was 32 years ago. Don't you think anything happened since then with science? Well, actually, it's been tremendous, tremendous discoveries, such as mapping the human genome and all these other genomes. That started in the year 2000. Before the year 2000, we didn't know any of this stuff, and now we not only have the human genome, we have all these other genomes, and they compare them, and that's called syntony. Do you know what syntony is? I mean, you said, I need to look into this stuff and not take people's words. I have looked into it. I know what syntony means. I know what pseudogenes are. I know what fused human chromosome 2 is. I know what this evidence is. Did you know any of it? That's my question for you. So you said I should look into it. I have looked into this. I wonder if you've looked into it. Are you dismissing things that you don't even know what you're talking about?
Well, no, I don't think I'm dismissing. Okay. Yeah, I don't think I'm dismissing anything I don't know anything about. I have read on the very subjects you're describing. What I want to point out is that you don't seem to recognize what is and what is not proved by these things. By showing the similarities and dissimilarities between the genome of a human and an ape, for example, you have only shown that their genomes are similar in certain ways and dissimilar in other ways. Your assumption is that they had a common ancestor, and that explains these similarities and dissimilarities. That's an assumption. That is a philosophy. That is not proven. There are other possibilities, one of which is a supernatural one, and there may be even others that are not supernatural. Scientists are still looking for the best theory possible. And it's true, you're right, that the status quo is belief in evolution. But many are seeing it as a shaky foundation. And many people are saying we might be looking for other theories, whether supernatural or not.
Go ahead, Truman.
Okay, well, again, Steve, I would say, do you know what in biology syntony means? Because you say, oh, you know, there's just similarities. It's much stronger than just similarities. There's also, it also shows descent. Because you can see how the bits in DNA change across genomes of different animals. It's the same way you can tell somebody, if you're a teacher and somebody in your class is cheating, you can tell from looking at that. In fact, even in biblical interpretation, you get different manuscripts to find out what the correct manuscript is, because there's no correct manuscript. You piece these different things together to find out what, you know, as close as you can what the original is. You can see these same descent things in the genome. I don't think you know what syntony is, do you? Do you know what syntony is?
I don't know the word syntony. I'll just tell you right there. But I do know the comparisons of the genome are what people are using nowadays, basically to say that evolution is confirmed. But many geneticists say it is not confirmed by that. It only confirms what we already would have known from looking at the gross anatomy of these animals, that they're they pretty much follows the same taxonomical patterns that they had before they studied the genomes. And that what it means is that some animals are much closer to each other than others in similarity. But to say that it proves descent requires something more than that. We need to actually see some evidence of descent, or we don't have any proof. We have only one's interpretation of the data. To say that your interpretation of the data is the only possible one is to be naive. There's frankly a lot more people out there writing on this subject than those who agree with you.
15 seconds.
I'll yield.
Truman?
Yeah, well, I just have to say, if you knew what syntony was, it's not just a matter of similarities. Syntony also shows descent. You can see the descent. You know, like, for example, if I had footsteps from my house to my car, and there's sand in between, and you saw the footprints, I could say, look, those footprints are signs that I went from my car to my house. I didn't just magically appear there. Now, somebody else might say, like, oh, well, you know, there's other ways to explain that, but those footsteps are exactly what we see in the genome. And pseudogenes are another example. Of course, I mean, everything is based on observation in science. I mean, science is a lot of deduction. They say they found the Higgs boson lately. How? By deduction. They didn't actually see it. 15
seconds.
You know, sometimes you say, like, well, if this happens, we should see this and this and this. And because of that, we can deduce this happened. This happens all the time in science.
All right.
Yeah, go, Steve.
All right. Well, Truman, I'm afraid I just don't trust your ability to tell what evidence leads to. I've read your book, and I'm not impressed with the idea that you can take evidence and give logical conclusions. You seem to take certain facts and conclude certain things that they don't prove. And so I'm not really that interested in what you think about this. I'm interested in what can be proven, and you haven't shown that. Of course, I can't expect you to show that in a minute. We have too little time here to do that. The point I'm making is neither of us are experts in genetics, I don't think, but we both read a fair bit about it. We have read different conclusions from different experts, the ones who have more knowledge of it. I don't believe that the analogy of footprints is a correct analogy there. But you know, we're talking over everyone's heads, including our own. The experts disagree about this, and so it hasn't been proven to the satisfaction of everyone.
Okay, last 1 minute, Truman. Truman.
Hello?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Your last segment. Okay, again, I want to state that there is scientific consensus. It is totally inaccurate and wrong to say that this is something that, I mean, I'm saying virtually all biological scientists, all universities, everybody, there is no controversy over evolution. It's really only between, you know, I'm trying to be respectful, but it's only between ignorant people. It's people who don't know the science. Ken Ham, for example, is a young earther, and Ray Comfort just put out this video about against evolution. But Ken Ham, for example, he admits that he uses the Bible as a science textbook and interprets everything through the Bible. Well, that's the problem, because the Bible is not a scientific textbook. So anyway, there is no controversy in the academic world.
Steve, you got the last 1 minute before the question from a caller.
Okay. Well, I think Truman simply doesn't read very widely, and he's only read within the range of people who he agrees with. In 2001, the Weekly Standard, October 1st, printed a two-page spread called A Scientific Descent from Darwinism, where 100 biologists, chemists, and zoologists, and physicists, and anthropologists, not creationists, molecular and cell biologists, geologists, and other scientists wrote, "We are skeptical of the claims of the ability of random mutation and natural selection to account for the complexity of life." This is not an unusual situation. There's lots of scientists who say that. In fact, Larry Hatfield in Science Digest in 1979 said, "Scientists who utterly reject evolution may be one of our fastest-growing controversial minorities." Scientists who utterly reject evolution, one of our fastest-growing controversial minorities. Many of the scientists supporting this position hold impressive credentials in science, unquote. So it's not a slam dunk.
Okay, that's time. So now I'm hoping that we have John from Seattle on the line.